Have a look into page number 153, exemptions under customs. There are few exemptions with respect to payment of customs duty. So these are given under multiple sections. In that, the first four sections we are trying to analyze, that is section 13, section 22, section 23 subsection 1 and section 23 subsection 2. So section 13 is about pilferage. So what is pilferage? Pilferage refers to petty theft. So whenever there is a petty theft, that is like goods are imported and some petty theft happens, then no duty payable on the pilfered goods. That is about section 13. Then section 23 subsection 2 talks about relinquishment of title. Relinquishment of title means, so leaving the title to the goods so that you don't have to pay customs duty. Then 23 subsection 1, remission of duty. Whatever duty that you have paid, so suppose if the goods are destroyed, so they will give the refund of that duty, that is known as remission of customs duty. And 22 is abatement in case of damage or deterioration to the goods. The value of the goods have come down, so now you don't have to pay the original customs duty, you pay the proportionate customs duty. So when is it applicable? So section 13, 23 subsection 1, 23 subsection 2 and 22. So first we have seen when it will be applicable. So title we have completed. So title is worth 13. So no duty payable on pilfered goods. 22, so abatement. 23 subsection 1, that is remission of duty. 23 subsection 2, relinquishment of title. When applicable? In case of petty theft, section 13 is applicable. Goods are pilfered, that is petty theft. When the goods are damaged or deteriorated, the goods are there, but it is damaged or deteriorated, section 22 will be applicable. And when the goods are lost, destroyed, written off, so suppose if the goods are completely destroyed, then remission of duty, 23 subsection 1. Suppose if goods are not according to the specifications, you imported some goods and that is different from what you have placed as an order, so goods not conforming to the specifications, 23 subsection 2 applicable. Okay, and then what is the benefit that you get in case of section 13 pilferage? You don't have to pay customs duty at all, whereas in case of abatement you need to pay customs duty. That is last column, section 22, you need to pay customs duty, but that customs duty will be payable at the reduced proportion. So whatever is the value of the goods before damage, for that what is the customs duty? Now what is the value of the goods after damage? So the proportionate customs duty will be payable. Okay, so that is this. And then in case of 23 subsection 1, remission of duty, I told you first we need to pay duty and we need to prove that the goods are destroyed, then whatever duty that we have paid, that will be refunded. So that is this. Whereas in case of section 23 subsection 2, relinquishment of title, no need to pay the customs duty. So these are the benefits that we get. Then remarks, suppose if it is pilfered, you don't have to pay customs duty, but if the goods are restored, then you need to pay the customs duty. What is that? So generally the goods are under the control of a custodian, so the custodian will be paying the customs duty because the goods are pilfered. So now the custodian will replace the goods, so he will identify the goods pilfered. So whenever that goods are restored, then in that case, customs duty is payable by the importer on those goods. Then relinquishment, remember, is not possible in case of prohibited goods. Already the goods imported are prohibited goods. That prohibited goods, if you say that I will relinquish the title, they will not give you any kind of benefit. Then how do we calculate customs duty proportionately? I told you, for example, if the value of the goods before damage is 1800 lakhs and for this, if 380 lakhs is the customs duty payable. Now after damage, the value of the goods is 1250 lakhs. Now proportionately, we need to pay customs duty. So 1250 into 380 divided by 1800, that comes to 263.88 lakhs is payable. Which means in the place of 380 lakhs, we are paying 263.88 lakhs. So what is the abatement? So the abatement is 116.11 lakhs. So therefore abatement equals to, therefore abatement, reduction. What is the reduction? 116.11 lakhs is what is reduced. Okay, so that's how we need to compute. So customs duty payable equals to value after damage. Okay, cross multiplication, 380 lakhs into 1250. So value after damage into original customs duty divided by value before damage. Okay, divided by value before damage will be taken. Then whether it is applicable in case of warehoused goods. See, there are total 4 sections. 13 is not applicable for warehoused goods. And same way, relinquishment of title also not applicable in case of warehoused goods. But in case of warehouse goods, another relinquishment is given as per proviso to section 68. But this section is not applicable in case of warehoused goods. That proviso to section 68 is not applicable for your syllabus, because warehousing provisions are deleted from your syllabus for CA final exams. Okay, so therefore in case of warehoused goods, pilferage is also not applicable, relinquishment of title is also not applicable. And what about remission of duty? The goods are kept in the warehouse and the goods got destroyed. So in that case, can we get the benefit? Yes, we can get the benefit. And same way, damage. So remember, deterioration, no. Damage, yes. See, deterioration should happen only before unloading. Only before unloading the goods, if the goods are deteriorated, you will get the benefit of abatement under section 22. But damage anytime thereafter, even in case of warehoused goods. Okay, so remember, deterioration is at any time before unloading goods. Before unloading of goods, you identify that the goods are deteriorated, so then only you will get the abatement under section 22. After the goods are unloaded and if it is deteriorated, after the goods are unloaded and taken to warehouse and if it is deteriorated, you will not get any benefit under section 22. Okay. Then section 21 refers to derelict, jetsam, flotsam and wreck. So whenever the ship got derailed and the goods are thrown into the water and if it continues floating and the damaged parts of the ship, if any of these are brought into India or is coming to India and some person has taken over the possession of those parts, so then that person has to pay customs duty. Unless such goods are exempted from payment of customs duty, they need to pay. That is about this section 21. So these are the 4 cases. And sir, when I need to claim which benefit? So section 13 and section 23 subsection 2, relinquishment before order, because it is not applicable in case of warehoused goods. So before order, so that's what I have given there. Goods are unloaded in the port or airport. Thereafter, order for clearance is made. And thereafter, either it will be taken for home consumption or it will be taken to a warehouse. And from warehouse, it will be cleared for home consumption. Okay. So now, before that order for clearance, you should have claimed pilferage, or you should have claimed, relinquishment of title. So this pilferage and relinquishment of title is not possible thereafter. But what about the other 2 sections? At any time you can claim, even before the order for clearance or after the order for clearance, the other 2 sections. What is that? That is remission of duty and abatement. You can claim before the order of clearance or after the order of clearance. But 2 sections we have restriction, that the benefit can be claimed before order for clearance if you identify that the goods are pilfered, or if you identify that the goods are not according to the specifications. So that is with respect to this. Then there is one more important point, that is reimportation of goods. That is whenever there is an import, we will pay customs duty, and those goods are exported. For what purpose it is exported? It is exported normally. If it is exported normally, you will be claiming some duty drawback and some benefits. Okay. Now upon re-import of that goods, at the time of export, whatever benefit you have claimed, that you need to repay. Okay. So again, I'm repeating. So you are generally importing goods and those goods you are exporting. Upon export, you will claim some benefits called as duty drawback or refunds, etc. You will claim refunds under GST or duty drawback under customs, or some other incentives under FTP you will claim. Now those goods are again re-imported. When it is re-imported, whatever benefits you claimed at the time of export, that needs to be repaid. But no need to pay original customs duty on that goods. So every import we need to pay customs duty, but that is not required to be paid, only concessional. How much concessional? At the time of export, whatever benefit you enjoy, that much if you pay, that will be sufficient. Provided the goods are imported within 3 years plus extended for a further period of 2 years. So within this time limit, if it is imported, what if it is imported, that is re-imported after this time limit? If it is re-imported after this time limit, then you need to pay normal customs duty. Got it? And then next one, suppose if you are exporting, for what purpose? Imported goods are exported for what purpose? For the purpose of repairs. So imported goods are exported for the purpose of repairs. So in that case, so now upon re-import, so at the time when you are exporting it for repairs, you will not claim any duty drawback. See, duty drawback can be claimed only when the goods are exported. So completely, and at the time of export itself, if you know that the goods are taken out for repairs, so why will you claim duty drawback? So therefore, duty drawback not claimed. Now it is exported, but and again it is re-imported after repairs. Now again we need to take the value of the goods which are re-imported and pay customs duty. No, so only the fair value of the repairs. So when we are sending abroad for repairs, whatever is the fair value of the repairs plus freight and insurance, both ways should be added, and on that only customs duty is payable. Okay, fair cost of repairs including material and labor plus freight and insurance, both ways should be taken, and on that only customs duty payable. Is it clear? So this, suppose if it is covered under warranty, if it is covered under warranty, we are not paying anything for repairs now, sir, what we should do? So that's why they use the word fair value of the repairs. Fair value of the repairs means what if it is not covered under warranty, there could be some value for some cost incurred now. So that value we need to take, both material and labor plus freight and insurance, both ways should be added. Okay, that on that customs duty paid, that is sufficient. Should we pay even IGST? Everything we will pay. Only thing is that the value will come down. Okay, that is this. Provided it is within 3 years, which can be extended for a further period of 2 years. What if it is sent abroad for repairs and if it is coming after 5 years? Then in that case, as if it is new goods which are imported, you pay customs duty. So this is about notification 45/2017, re-importation of goods exported. Okay, 45/2017. There is another notification 60/2018, 158 of 95 as amended by notification 60/2018. So what is this about? Here, there it is, first import, then export, again re-import. Here it is, first we have exported. First we have exported and we are importing it for carrying out repairs in India, and once the repairs are carried out in India, it will be re-exported. Okay. So first it will be export, then again import, and thereafter it is re-export. Now, when you are exporting, at the time of re-import, whether you need to pay any customs duty? No. At the time of re-import, you are not required to pay, that is at the time of import, you don't have to pay any customs duty. First, you exported some manufactured goods in India, yeah? And when you are importing it, so no customs duty payable. Customs duty not payable on import, provided not payable on import, provided the goods are imported within the time limit. Okay, for what purpose? For what purpose it is imported? For carrying out repairs, reconditioning, refurbishing, etc. And thereafter, it should have been exported after completing that process. Okay, so now, what is the time limit within which it should be imported from the date of export? For what purpose it is imported, it depends. If it is imported for reprocessing, refining, or remaking, then it should be imported within 1 year. Suppose if it is for repairs or reconditioning, it should be imported within 3 years. And if it is notified goods, 7 years. And in case of Nepal and Bhutan, notified goods or other goods, 10 years. Okay. Now, see the difference. In case of reprocessing, refining, remaking, see, these are it with respect to manufacturing defects. So manufacturing defects you will be able to identify within 1 year. So therefore, within 1 year it should be brought. But repairs and reconditioning is based on usage. First, they need to use. Only when they use, we will be able to notice what are the issues in that. So therefore, in case of repairs or reconditioning, so notified goods or other than notified goods, we need to see. If it is notified goods, within 7 years. And if it is other than notified goods, within 3 years. And in case of Nepal and Bhutan, 10 years, let it be notified or other than notified. By the time, if it is brought, then no need to pay customs duty. What if we are bringing beyond that time, we need to pay customs duty. And moreover, it should be exported back within 6 months plus 6 months. It should be exported back within 6 months plus 6 months after completing that repairs or remaking or reprocessing, refining, etc. And one more point also, whatever we have imported and exported should be same. Suppose if some other goods are replaced, so then this benefit is not applicable. The same point is applicable even in the above case also. So whatever we have exported, that only should come. Suppose if some other goods comes as a replacement, then this benefit will not be applicable. Same way here, whatever is imported, the same should be exported after repairs or reconditioning. Okay. Then on import, no customs duty payable. So these are the two notifications along with the time limits, try to remember. And this point related to this fair cost of repairs plus fire insurance both ways, on that equation can be framed. Okay. Then suppose, sir, in case of notification 60/2018, the goods are being imported and there is some process loss. So because of that process loss, so we could not export it fully. So is it permitted? Yes, that will be permitted. So you can see that if any loss of imported goods is noticed during such operation, such loss shall be exempt from whole of the customs duty, subject to the satisfaction of ACDC of customs. Okay. Then section 24. So 20 we have seen. Now two notifications, that is notification number 45/2017 and 60/2018. 21, denaturing or 21 is derelict jetsam, flotsam, etc. That one. 22 is abatement. 23 subsection 1 is remission of duty. 23 subsection 2, relinquishment of duty. 24 is there, denaturing and mutilation of goods. So denaturing refers to diluting the goods. So whenever we are importing some goods which are chargeable to duty at different rates depending upon the purpose. So now you will denature it such a way that it is unfit for the other purpose, so that you will pay only that customs duty. So therefore that is known as denaturing. For example, if H2SO4 is imported, sulfuric acid. So that sulfuric acid, if it is used for manufacture, we need to pay 15% as a customs duty. And if it is for laboratories, experiment purpose, then it will be nil rate. So therefore, depending upon the purpose, it is taxable. So now what purpose we are importing? We are importing for laboratories. Then dilute the H2SO4 such that it will be unfit for manufacturing purpose. So then you don't have to pay any customs duty. That is known as denaturing of goods. And mutilation of goods means, so whenever you are importing some machinery and that machinery is chargeable to duty, if you import the parts of the machinery which is exempted from duty, so then when you are importing a second hand machine, you break that machine because the purpose is only parts you need, you don't need the entire machine, break the machine and only parts you clear, so that you know the remaining things you sell as a scrap there itself before clearance itself, so that on parts only you will pay customs duty. So that is nil rate or exempted. Okay. So that is known as mutilation of goods. Owner of the goods will make request for denaturing, that is diluting the chemicals, and mutilation, breaking machinery. I gave two examples. So central government may make rules in this regard. Duty is payable as if the goods are imported in denatured or mutilated form, so that we can pay the reduced customs duty. Okay. So these are the various exemptions that we have in customs.